Hi, everyone. Thanks for joining us. My name is Rob Morandi. I'm a first-year MBA student here at MIT Sloan and the student lead for today's panel, The Long Thaw, Hockey's Embrace of Analytics. It's my pleasure to introduce our speakers and moderator to you today. Starting at the end, we have Dmitry Filipovich, a sports writer for Rogers Sportsnet, Hillary Knight, an Olympian and professional hockey player in the NWHL, Tyler Dello, former NHL analytics consultant, David Johnson, owner and operator of Puckalytics.com, and Josh Flynn, the director of hockey operations for the Columbus Blue Jackets. The way it's going to work today, it's going to be an hour long, about 45 minutes of moderator-led discussion, and then 15 minutes of audience-sourced questions via Twitter. The way to submit the questions are using the hashtag LongThaw, which you'll see on both of these screens in case you forget, and you can submit those throughout the panel, and we'll be keeping track of them and feeding the most retweeted and favorited questions up to the moderator. So with that, I'll turn it over to Dmitry. Thank you.
Should we start without Tyler here?
Yeah, go ahead.
Welcome to the Sloan Conference's Token Hockey panel. So I thought a good way to start this discussion would be trying to figure out a way, we were talking backstage about how we can make hockey analytics more accessible to the casual fan. I mean, we're probably preaching to the choir here since all these people, I imagine, are seeking it out and going out of their way and are already buying all we're selling. But how do we get the NHL to join, even like the NBA, for example, in sort of the public sphere? Feel free to, anyone can jump in.
We lost Tyler. I mean, he was the one that was all over this thing.
Okay, well, I guess I'll answer my own question. I think something we really struggle with these days is, especially with online analysis, it's turned into a bit of an echo chamber where everyone is kind of agreeing with most of the topics that we've already kind of determined to be true, and people aren't necessarily questioning stuff and asking relevant follow-up questions, and it's just, I don't know, we need to find a way to attract people that are necessarily already thinking along the same lines as us, rather than just kind of yelling back and forth between the same people all over and over again.
Yeah, I think a big thing is getting the NHL to, both the NHL and the media, to incorporate data into their broadcasts and tell stories using data as opposed to just, you know, the coach's opinion or an analyst's opinion. Find a way to back up those storylines with actual data. And I think that a big onus is on the NHL and the broadcasters to do that.
Tyler, welcome back to the conversation.
Thanks for having me back, Dmitry.
Do you have any thoughts on how we can get hockey analytics to more of a mainstream level to join the other major professional sports?
I think that the real challenge is telling stories, like in terms of from a media perspective, using it to tell stories that make the game more accessible or highlight why teams are good or why teams are bad. But we were talking a little bit about Columbus, and Columbus had a huge winning streak this year, and I assume most of that was Josh, but they won 16 in a row, 16? Yeah, 16 in a row. And like what I found fascinating is that the story was, oh, Columbus is winning, Columbus is winning. And there was, one of the big things to me was Columbus had this first unit power play, and it had Sam Gagne, Zach Werenski, Alex Winberg, Nick Foligno, Cam Atkinson, is that right?
Yep.
And it was unbelievable. They were scoring like the best power play unit of the last decade. But because the league doesn't gather and promote kind of on a per unit basis how power play units are doing, that story wasn't really out there. And so it was something that kind of a few people were kind of talking about quietly. And like people knew that you guys had a good power play, but they didn't know why. And they didn't know like specifically how good that unit was. And it's kind of funny too, because as good as that unit was, the other unit is kind of the polar opposite. So that's an opportunity where I think having better data and using it, or not, you don't even need better data, but sifting through the current data to extract stuff like that makes it easier to tell compelling stories to fans, and I think would push this thing forward.
And it would have been a good story, I suppose, because it was a big driver of why we were so successful. When you're scoring a power play goal every game, sometimes two power play goals a game, it's hard to,
Yeah.
You have to,
Sorry. Excuse me. Go ahead, Josh.
It makes it a lot easier to have success. Any game that's going to be a close game gets broken open by that one power play goal. So we win 16 in a row, and our power play is red hot. And even before that, before the 16-game winning streak, we were playing very well, and our power play was still, if I don't remember if it was number one in the league, but it was up there. It was a big driver of our success. So I think he's right. It could have been a story that could have been told better, and there's data on it. And I know in his sphere, he told that story, and there's some others that told that story, but I don't know if it got brought to the forefront.
And I think a big background to that story is that these players are not necessarily the league superstars. They're not the Crosbys, the Malkins. I mean, if it was Crosby and Malkin doing that, well, you know, we kind of expect that. But it was kind of out of the blue and unexpected. And I think that kind of adds to the story. It could have really been a bigger story.
Well, I wonder, even with the data we do have right now, have we boxed ourselves in a little bit with sort of the nomenclature we chose in our early years, where maybe it might be a bit of a barrier to entry, or people might find, you know, I think any hockey player, anyone that's watched the game would agree that intuitively it makes sense to, you know, have the puck as much as possible and get as many pucks on net as you can. It's a very common verbiage. But like, once you put titles like Corsi or Fenwick or whatever, it might be a turnoff to certain people.
Yeah, it's really interesting. Just from the women's hockey perspective, we don't necessarily have the same access to the data that you guys have. So I think that's where we can really join the conversation and find that competitive edge. Mm-hmm. But right now, we've really changed around our systems just in the last short couple of years here, from sort of a dump and chase and make the opponent skate the full length of the ice. And now we're seeing the NHL change their systems as well and seeing, okay, they might be onto something here. And from a traditional standpoint, you're like, okay, I'm sort of a north to south player. You know, this doesn't feel right. But then when you back it up with the data and you see what's going on in the NHL and just being a part of those different style games or adding an extra forward when there's usually a D, it really changes the makeup of the game and it makes it more fun in certain areas.
Yeah. Well, I think that the next steps for us is going to be sort of taking all this stuff that's a bit theoretical and getting more practical usage out of it. And we were talking backstage before about how you guys have started recently implementing the four forwards, one defenseman on the power play.
Yeah, it was funny just because, you know, from a player's perspective, again, our coaches were just saying, okay, we're going to do four forwards. And we're like, what? Like, I'm a forward. I don't really skate backwards. I don't pivot very well. And they said, okay, we're just going to try this. And it was incredible. I mean, at first, you're sort of on your heels and trying to anticipate different plays, and then once you got into the game and locked in, you could see the huge competitive advantage that it added because it did open up different lanes, and you got different looks when you're entering a blue line or different shots on net, so it definitely changed the makeup.
Well, when your coach approaches you and says, you know, we're going to try something fundamentally different, because I feel like hockey is very stuck in its ways and it's very conventional, and a lot of times we don't try out new stuff just because we've always done it a certain way. And so as a player, if a coach approaches you and says, we're going to do something completely different here, hear me out. Our analysts have told us this is what we should be doing, but we have to actually see it on the ice. Like, is there like a bit of a pushback there, or is it just listening to your coach?
Driven by a non-hockey player?
Yeah. you know, I see both sides of it. I think at first, just from the feeling standpoint of it all, you're like, oh my gosh, this guy's crazy. But he's our coach, so we're going to follow what he says. And then once you get the adrenaline going, you lock in the game, and you just see how the game sort of unfolds. It's really beautiful in the way that it opens it up in a different perspective. So coming from the traditional standpoint and then adding this sort of advanced competitive edge, it definitely changes the way that you see the game, and I think it's not necessarily a bad thing once you get over that original hump that you're out of your comfort zone.
Right. Josh, we were talking about how, you know, the other side of it is if you're trying to pitch, you know, your GM or your owner or something to actually implement some of this stuff and make radical change. How does that work? Because I imagine you kind of have to use delicate language not to scare them off.
Yeah, I don't think you're trying to make radical change, though, really. I think a lot of the concepts that are being discussed in the world of hockey analytics, a lot of them are rooted in common sense. Mm-hmm. And you talked before about the names we've given them and the novelty of the of these metrics that have been adopted over the last few years. A lot of them, when you dive into them, they reflect what you already thought about the game. And it's where they don't that generates interesting discussion. But for the most part, it does. So it's really easy when you're working with people to sell the concept, because it's something that when you explain it and how it works, it just, it's another name for something that they already believe in.
Right. I wonder, though, if it would be a bit different, like where we can really learn and grow is when you find stuff that challenges your original beliefs. Like, what if you pitch them on something where they're like, just, it's so different from what they've grown accustomed to thinking about the game?
Yeah, I'm not really sure that anything that dramatic has happened. It's been, you know, pointing out some outliers or, you know, when we have our scouting meetings, we'll bring up some of the guys for our scouts who maybe some of these metrics have pointed out might not be good as good as they thought or might be better than they thought, and just challenge the biases they form from watching it and then have them defend it. And usually you can, it's just a good conversation starter. It's a good way to get to dig deeper and get to the bottom of what a player brings and what he is. And I don't think I'm ever going to sit in a room with our management team or with a coach or our scouts and say, no, you guys are wrong and these numbers are right. Like, listen to me. I mean, it's just not going to, at least in my experience, it's never played out that way.
Well, I wonder how much that's going to change once we get more information with regards to player tracking and get establishing bigger data sets like that. I mean, Hillary, would you be open to playing with like a tracking chip or something under your equipment to get some more of this stuff?
Yeah, absolutely. I think, you know, just hockey as a sport in general, just in terms of equipment, has come such a long way, and what's gone into even just making our sticks or our skates or whatnot. So I think this is the next component that's going to be super valuable to us as a sport.
Yeah, I mean, there's been certain companies that have been kind of trying to test some of this stuff out, and it's received a lot of pushback in the hockey community, whether it's Sport Logic or something like that. And it's, I don't know, like, David, do you want to talk a little bit about the differences between descriptive and predictive?
Well, just going back to the player tracking, and I think that's really the next level for the NHL, is when we get that, you look at how it's transformed basketball and baseball. When we can track where the player is, how fast he's moving, where the puck is, how fast it's moving, there's just so much more we can do to analytically describe what's going on. And I think that's really going to revolutionize the game and what we can quantify and how it matters and how it's producing positive or negative outcomes. Mm. And I think that's really where we got to go. We're kind of hitting the wall where we're at now with the data we have. So I think that's where we need to go to take it to the next level.
Well, I'm kind of, Josh, you can probably answer this as well as anyone on this panel, but I think a question people generally have is how different is the stuff that front offices are working with behind the scenes versus what we have available to us in the public sphere?
I think what's available in the public sphere, I think it's just a difference in timing. I think we use a lot of the stuff that's in the public sphere, and I think I can only speak for my team, but I think around the league, teams are trying different things, and whether they use it's going to depend on how it works when they try it. When I came to Columbus, we wanted to try and place a value on draft picks and try and organize the way we were handling the draft, not in terms of valuing the players, but just in terms of managing the assets. And we built a draft pick value chart and tried to predict the success rate of different picks. And now, I mean, I don't know if we were the first, but we started doing it 9 years ago. So we were one of the early ones on it. And I didn't, at the time, I never heard about anybody else doing it. Now everybody's doing it.
Right.
So over time, I mean, personnel moves from one team to the other. They take a good idea. I had a scout come from another team and tell me, hey, we had this idea with our old team, and this is what we did. And I said, no, we can do something like that. And then we kind of adopted that idea. So I think the good ideas build, and then eventually they filter out to the public. Whether one team's ahead or of another in a certain field, or ahead of the public in a certain brand of analytic, I mean, you don't know. We're certainly trying some things, and if it bears fruit, then it'll become part of our process. But yeah.
Tyler, do you have any thoughts on this?
Sorry, what was the question?
We're just talking about the differences between what's publicly available to us right now versus what teams are actually operating with behind the scenes?
Well, it's interesting. Like I talk to a lot of teams, or I know a lot of people now within the game. And my sense is that the teams aren't maybe as far ahead as people think. And I know like everybody wants to believe that their team has some secret magic, some secret data. And like I've plowed through stuff to try and pull out insights, and it's hard and it takes effort, and you have to do a lot of work. And you know, so I'm skeptical that anybody, or there are some teams that absolutely, I have no doubt, are miles ahead of the public. But I think in general, the gap between where teams are and where the public is isn't nearly as big as people think.
So what do you think is the next thing? Because obviously, we're trying to kind of get ahead of the curve here and find the next market inefficiency or the next place that you can extract value from. Is it what we were hearing Cam Lawrence and Eric Joyce talk about with regards to their draft, or is there something else on an in-game basis that we can kind of look into?
There's two things there that really catch my mind. Like one, you know, and I'm going to keep it to myself, but there's one area that I think is ripe for a lot of change, and I think you're going to see it change a lot in the NHL over the next 10 years. Mm-hmm. Like I think it's an area where teams can make massive gains. But again, you know, I haven't talked about that publicly, and I'll hold that one to myself. But the other one, I think, you know, like the way that teams evaluate defensemen, I think that's a huge issue. And you see so many defensemen every year get signed, and then 2 years later, it's like you can't give the guy away at his contract price. Mm-hmm. And I think that there's ways with what's available right now that teams could do it a lot better. And you can go back and look at a past decision and sort of show, look, this information at the time showed that this was a bad idea, and now it's 2 years later, and you've still got another year of this guy. I'm not going to say his name, but you know, there's a specific guy I was thinking of as I said that.
Yes.
So you know, I think, you know, from a team perspective, Billy Beane talked yesterday about walking around picking up dollar bills that are just lying on the ground, mm-hmm. and there's a lot of that out there right now that just isn't being done.
Well, I think we just generally struggle quite a bit with evaluating defensemen. I mean, a big topic of discussion lately has been how much quality of competition really matters and whether we should be focusing more on contextualizing a player's performance based on that. Hillary, as a player, like I imagine that knowing what your role is on a team and whether you have to go up against the other team's best defense pairing, other team's top line versus maybe playing against some softer competition would influence both your numbers, but also just like the mentality of what you're trying to accomplish on the ice.
Yeah, you hope it doesn't influence your numbers, but you know, at the same time, you need to respect your opponent. But it definitely changes the way that you approach your tactic within that game, especially specifically as a line, but also as a five woman or man unit. So, you know, at the beginning, you know, you're going against a hot centerman, so you might be losing more draws, so you have less opportunity in certain areas. But it all depends sort of who you're playing against and what type of style of play you're applying there.
I mean, is what we're missing on defensemen as simple as just trying to find like the perfect recipe or perfect combination for evaluating all those factors? Because it seems like it's something that's really been eluding us in the past few years.
Yeah, I think it's really a question of, you know, trying to sort through all the context that surrounds a defenseman's performance. And it's interesting, like I saw a model that somebody's put out, and he was kind of tweeting out excerpts from it or highlights, and he tweeted out, you know, a thing about Adam Larson. And he showed, you know, look, Adam Larson has no value. And it's funny, because if you looked at it, according to his model, Adam Larson lost all his value in 2014-15. Mm-hmm. And I happen to know a lot about Adam Larson. And so I went back and looked, and I happened to notice that the timing when this guy said, or when this guy's model said that Adam Larson became useless, at that exact same moment, he was pushed onto New Jersey's top pair, and New Jersey was playing their top pair in the defensive zone like nobody in the league. Like, it is ridiculous. And not only that, but they played the toughest, like in terms of, like, I'll measure it by just looking against how, you know, what percentage of your time is against star forwards. Mm-hmm. And they were at the top of that. So you're into a situation where, you know, there's a lot of people who are skeptical of the value of quality competition. And, you know, I think zone starts can be overstated, but when you're at the extremes, they do matter. So I don't know the extent to which models necessarily capture the guys at the edges. But if you go back and plow through the context, you can see, okay, well, this changed, and all of a sudden the results changed. Maybe he didn't suddenly become a terrible player. Maybe the context changed.
Well, also part of the trick is, like, the best defensive player is probably the one that you never actually see, where it's just like being in a good defensive position and not allowing anything to materialize in the first place, and that would never really show up in the numbers of the box score. But I mean, obviously, I guess if you keep playing defensively sound hockey, it'll add up.
Absolutely. I know when you go against a hot defenseman, it's very frustrating in that standpoint, but it'll definitely change your numbers when you're kind of adding everything up at the end of the day.
David, do you have any thoughts on defensemen and on ice save percentage?
I think in general we have a hard time quantifying defensive play. And certainly quality of competition seems to be a factor, but it's difficult to quantify exactly how and why. And I don't know whether it's a combination of when you're facing the top opponents, you change your style a little bit to be a little more conservative, and that affects your stats, maybe more so than the actual competition, or how much does the competition really matter? And it's a really difficult question to get to without knowing in detail about how what the player's mindset was and whether they changed their style of play when their quality of competition changed.
I think David's point leads to I think David's point leads to an interesting one, just talking about defensemen. I'm not convinced even that quality of competition is like linear in the sense that if you play the best players, you get X, and if you go down, you get, you know, a little bit worse. I suspect you might find that there's some players who are better suited to defend against the best players, but if they're playing against weaker players, their results aren't going to be as good as maybe another guy who can handle, like David Schlemko is maybe an example, right? Like he'll do well against lower end competition, but I'm not sure that if you pushed him all the way up, he would handle it as well. And sort of, you know, conversely, there'll be guys who play, like it's all about how do you structure your team to get the most value out of it. And I suspect, and this is something, you know, like I think this is a really good area for someone to dig into, is, you know, are there specific defensemen who do better against a specific class of players or provide more value against a specific class of players than they necessarily would if you move them up or down the lineup.
Yeah,
I think you can take it a step further and say, are there pairs of defensemen that work better together than a different pair?
Well, I think that's, I have no doubt that that's true. Like there's one of the best pieces of research I've seen the last year was a piece talking about right and left-handed defense pairs. And it was done by, the guy's name is Dom, and I hate that do you know his last name?
Luchizhin or something?
No, it's not him. It's he's on Twitter, he's at Mimico Hero, so he should have used his full name. Dom Gallimani, there you go. But he showed how there's been this huge change in the NHL from right-left defense pairs over the last decade, and it's become much more common. And there's a real obvious hockey reason why you'd want to do that. But you can see, you know, changes in the results based on the handedness of the partner.
Yes. If you've been playing a certain way the entire time, like back to the conversation we had about the power play, like if all of a sudden you're being asked to kind of play in a more defensive role and backtrack as a forward, but you've never really been asked to do that before, there's like an adjustment curve there as well.
Yeah, definitely. You know, as a player, you always go off of feeling and muscle memory, and you don't necessarily want to think about what you're doing when you're out there because you want to make decisions within less than a split second. So if it does depend on how you're feeling and how you're going against your defenseman, or if you're a gamer and you get up for the competition, or maybe you don't, you're not as skilled enough to play the top competition. So it's a lot of the mindset of who's actually on the ice and how you're applying these different techniques.
Yeah, I think... Go for it.
Yeah, I think with respect to defensemen and quality of competition, I think it's very difficult to quantify, but from what I've observed, it's very real. Maybe not for, if you take 180 defensemen in the league, let's say six per team, and you take the middle 140, maybe it doesn't apply to them. But the 20 on either end, it applies for sure. And I think it's... So far, I haven't read anything or been able to determine any way to do it strictly with objective data to kind of figure it out. The way Tyler's been doing it, I think that's a really good way to do it. I mean, I'm a big believer in taking the work that our scouts do and trying to use that to solve these problems. And using some of their input and kind of classifying the competition from the data that scouts are giving us, we've been able to kind of look at it and say, okay, there's some defensemen that are playing in a whole different league, basically, because of who they play against, either on the plus side or the negative side. Yeah. And the results are different, and you know them, you go watch them, and you know that they're good defensemen. Yeah. But the numbers are saying something different, and the one big difference is the quality of competition. So it hasn't been proved statistically yet, but it's almost impossible for me to deny that it exists.
Yeah. I think you hit on the topic in general. We have these models, data models, and I think they work very well for maybe the middle 80%, but the 10% at either end, the outliers that I think we need more focus on, to what makes them outliers and how they differ from the general pool of players.
Right.
It's funny you mentioned that. Like, if you look at defensemen, the difference between their save percentage when they're on the ice and their team's save percentage when they're off, I'm pretty sure Nick Lidstrom's like at the top of the list. And, you know, I'm not a big believer in defensemen impacting save percentage at the NHL level, but I suspect it's not a coincidence that Nick Lidstrom's at the top of that list. Now, the thing is, Nick Lidstrom is sort of a once-every-40-year defenseman freak, and I don't know how much you can learn by, you know, just be like Nick Lidstrom. Well, that's great. Right. You know, shouldn't I be like Bobby Orr? Like, it's not necessarily something from which you can extrapolate lessons that you can then generalize. But the defenseman competition thing, I think, is very interesting, and it's a case where there was a study by Eric Tulski, and everyone knows Tulski and trusts him, he's a smart guy, and he wrote this study, and everyone seems to have decided he was right. And I think Eric's a dummy. I don't buy it. I'm kidding. He's a friend of mine. But I don't think that study necessarily conclusively proved it. But you're in a situation where a lot of people seem to have adopted that.
Yes.
And if you just look, like, this is just common sense. But if you look at how, let's take Mike Babcock, for example, you know, Morgan Riley plays 45% of his minutes against a list of guys who I think are the best 30 forwards or the best forward on each team in the NHL. Jake Gardner's playing 17%. And I hear people who say they're analytics people saying, well, everybody plays against everybody because if you run it Tulski's way, you'll get something similar.
Yes.
So I don't buy that. Like, I refuse to believe that that's a coincidence. Well, I know it's not a coincidence. Right. Like,
yeah, I think there's a few exceptions in Riley's one where he plays way more against the top players.
Sure, and like valuing that, I think, is a real challenge going forward. Like, if you look at San Jose, Brent Burns, one of the knocks on Brent Burns this year is Mark Edward Vlasic plays about the toughest minutes in the league.
Yes.
And Brent Burns plays less. So it's kind of a weighting contest between, you know, how do you weigh the fact that the coach clearly thinks he's, you know, the guy he wants out against the best players, and, you know, so much scoring happens when Burns is on the ice against the next tier of players. So how do you weight that in terms of figuring out, like, you know, if you're interested in it, who's the best defenseman in the NHL? And I think that is, you know, if you're an analytics guy looking for a way to make your name, solving that, I think, would be worth a lot.
And on top of it, Burns is asked to go out and generate offense, where Vlasic is maybe not.
Yeah, I guess that's... I don't know. I think when Vlasic goes up the ice, they tell him, hey, if you get a chance to score, score.
Like, sure. But when he's facing, you know, the other team's top line, maybe he doesn't take quite as many chances as Burns might.
That's possible. And, like it's interesting. Like, one of the things you find, if you get into sort of looking at how fourth lines play versus how first lines play, fourth lines, the shot numbers go way down. And it's interesting, like, I was at a game with my girlfriend in, like, 2009. She didn't know anything about hockey. She was new to it. And we were watching. She goes, you know, why did these guys always just shoot it in? And then one guy goes in and two guys sit back. And it was Edmonton's fourth line against Toronto's fourth line. And so nobody wanted to make a mistake. So all it was just up and down, dump, 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 dump. And, you know, so if you're a defenseman who's maybe less defensively accomplished, if you make a mistake when you're on the ice against those guys, the risk is different, because they might just, even if they get it, they'll go up and dump it in. Who cares?
Yeah.
So it's you know, that's where I think that can factor into it.
Let's move on to another hot button topic in the hockey analytics community lately, and it's the value of face-offs. Tyler, I know you've written about this recently.
Yeah, it's something I've written about. I think in general people are right that face-offs aren't worth as much as people think, and they're great for TV because it's something that they count and you can yell about it. And, like, there was a goal in Toronto recently where Austin Matthews was on the ice taking a face-off against Jack Eichel. and Jack Eichel loses the draw, or wins the draw, Matthews loses, defensive zone, and it goes like, Eichel wins it, over to the winger, back to the other winger, goal. And it's like within 3 seconds. And so instantly you get people screaming, oh yeah, tell me again how faceoffs don't matter, nerd. But the thing is, like,
we had the exact same thing happened in one of our games last week after we had this discussion.
Oh yeah?
Yeah.
Well, there you go. There you, and who is okay? Well, let me do this one then. I'll, like, so Austin Matthews, he's on his left side, his strong side. He's like a 50% faceoff guy there, and you know the NHL faceoff talents tend to range from like 40% to 60%. And Toronto doesn't have a 60% left-handed face-off guy. So I don't know how you can critique the decision that Babcock made to put him out there. And, you know, you're going to lose some face-offs over the course of the year. And so it's not that they're irrelevant. It's that it's hard, you know, except in some certain circumstances, to pull some real tactical things out of them. And that's where, you know, I think, do I think you can improve your face-offs by doing certain things? Absolutely. Is there kind of bulletproof evidence for that? Absolutely. Like, Calgary has Troy Brouwer. He's taken a lot of right-handed face-offs over the years. He's playing with Sam Bennett. Sam Bennett can't win them on the right side, or he has been playing with Bennett a bit. So why wouldn't you, and maybe he's hurt, like maybe there's a reason, but there's an opportunity there. Just don't have Bennett take those face-offs, you know? And that's where I think there's an interesting face-off discussion to be had, not getting on Twitter and screaming about a podcast for you to challenge people who can't skate and, you know, yell at analytics guys.
Who would ever do that?
I can't imagine.
Yeah, it's ultimately just, I mean, we agree that it's basically just another puck battle, but it's very easy to point to in those instances where it, like, directly leads in the defensive zone, you lose a draw cleanly, it leads to a goal, and it's easy for everyone to kind of complain about that.
If you look at the list of teams in the face-off rankings, I think, like, I don't know what it is today, but there was a one point last week when we were sitting around talking about this, you know, just shooting it, like, just saying, well, look, the bottom, I think it was six of the bottom seven teams in faceoffs this year are playoff teams, and I think four of the top five are not playoff teams. So, I mean, how much is that stat really worth? It gets magnified. Like I was saying, we had a game, I can't remember which game it was, but it was last week, and we had this discussion because that article came out, and then right off the face-off, the other team scored on us right off the draw, and I got a text from Yarmo or JD saying, oh, face-offs, they're just joking. But, I mean, like, it's one of these things that off that one play gets really magnified. But if you look at it, what the actual value of it, a good face-off man or a good face-off team, it hasn't really proven to be a whole lot. I used to say years ago that, like, if you were thinking about what you were going to pay a free agent who happened to be a better face-off man than an average face-off man, I kind of said it was like, you know, if you wanted a house, if you were looking at houses and the house had a pool, you were kind of like, well, that's a nice feature, but I'm not going to pay a whole lot more for it.
Yeah.
So it just, that's the kind of analogy I think of what it is on top of, you know, the rest of a player's skill set and how you value them.
Yeah. And it's just like for me, it's like you say, like, are you going to go very far out of your way to, you know, get stronger there? I don't think you should. At the same time, if there's free money lying on the ground, pick it up,
yeah,
right?
Yeah. I think the one thing I have seen is that a lot of the teams that do go deep into the playoffs and win cups have good face-off guys, but I think they also have elite centers.
Yes.
So if you have good centers and maybe the league's so young now, and a lot of younger players aren't the best face-off guys. If you can get your young players to be better face-off guys, they become more valuable players to you.
Yeah.
But I don't know if it's a skill you want to go out and pay for. And I mean, there's a time and place for everything, I suppose.
Well,
but
it's interesting from an organizational perspective. Like, the league is 65% left-hander, the forwards are. So from an organizational perspective, when you draft a right-handed guy, even if he's a winger and you project him as a winger, why are you not telling him at 18, hey, you're going to learn how to take face-offs? Mm-hmm. And you should be doing it. And I know some teams, like minor league teams, where they tell the guys, like, absolutely, like, if you know, learn how to take face-offs, learn how to take face-offs, because it's another tool in your toolbox, and, you know, maybe that, and coaches love guys who can take face-offs, and, you know, if you're a player, and that keeps you in the year, in the league for an extra year at the end of your career, that's a pretty good return on your investment, yeah. Getting out there and doing draws.
So we talked earlier about the concept of storytelling in hockey and how we can kind of captivate and draw in more fans with it. I mean, a big point of contention for people is with face-offs and plus-minus, how in-game broadcasts and studio panels seem to just constantly harp on them because they're kind of an easy thing to do, and those stats have been around forever. Like, how can we make changes to that? Like, what would you like to see talked about instead on those?
Go ahead, Dave. I don't know who you're talking to. You're just looking down here, saying words.
Whoever wants to take it.
I think it's finding the story to tell and getting the data out there so that the public knows it. The great thing about face-offs is everybody knows what a face-off is, and the data is there. It's easily, you can go to NHL.com, find out what some guy's face-off percentage is. It's easily available. And the big thing is getting the other data that we find important, easily available and understandable by the average fan. So that when it's brought up in a broadcast, they know exactly what it is, as opposed to thinking like, what are the guy talking about? This, what is this? What does this mean? It just takes time to bring the average fan on board, and you just got to simplify it down to a level where they can understand how it impacts winning and losing and scoring goals.
What I like, you know, I'd like to be more about stuff that you know matters. Like, so take that face-off, for example. Like, yeah, it sucks to lose a face-off and give up a goal, but does that tell me any bigger truth? Like, sort of going, you should have won that face-off. Because, you know, like I said, Babcock had the right guy in the right spot. Just, you know, didn't work out. And that's going to happen. And so to me, what's interesting is when you can use the data to identify something that's really a driver in a team's success or failure, and then you can point that out. So, you know, like, I don't think you guys are on Hockey Night in Canada all that often.
Probably not.
No. But when Columbus was having their hot streak, if they were on Hockey Night in Canada and that information had been fed to the guys, you know, doing the broadcast about, hey, you know, Gagne, Wenberg, Werenski, Foligno, and Atkinson, they're like having this historic season as a five-man unit. Then all of a sudden, you know, they've got good analysts. Like, they've got, you know, like the people who work for them know the game. But you can really focus their attention on something that we know is making a huge difference, rather than kind of a scattershot approach, well, here's a thing that happened. And so, you know, where I think hockey, you know, coverage is kind of behind what you see in the NBA or the NFL is that, you know, they're getting these very focused stories about things that are affecting the league or affecting the games, like why Golden State wins. And we don't get as much of that in hockey.
Yesterday during the great sort of GM panel with guys like Billy Beane and Daryl Morey and Sam Hinkie, an interesting thing came up where Billy Beane was talking about the idea of team culture and chemistry. And I've always been of the belief that, you know, winning goes a long way towards solving that. I think that you probably get along with your teammates a lot more when you're winning rather than if you're losing. It's kind of all of a sudden you get all these questions about whether people are getting along and whether the chemistry is a right fit.
Absolutely. You know, when the highs are high, you're up high, and then when they're low and you're losing, it's not always the greatest place to be. But I think that's why, you know, these different metrics are super important, you know, especially as a goal scorer. You know, you go out there, you're like, oh, I don't feel great. Like, I feel like I'm in a rut. But really, if you rely on the numbers and you peel everything back, you're like, okay, you know, I had 50-50 opportunity at this shot, and this is how this went. And you can really identify, you know, split the way you're feeling and based on the facts, and then go out there the next day and attack it. So I think it's a huge advantage to get a team out of a rut. But definitely when things are going well, it's a lot easier to get along. But, you know, we've got a great group of girls, so it's always a fun time to represent the country.
Well, Beane hinted at the fact that he thinks that sooner rather than later we'll be able to kind of quantify this a bit more. And obviously in hockey we have stuff like with or without you metrics, and we can sort of tell maybe who's dragging down certain teammates or who's playing well with who. But, like, beyond that, I mean, it still seems like there's quite a ways to go between bridging that gap between this sort of being this kind of intangible thought that we only think about in hindsight versus actually something we can incorporate in our analysis.
I think there's, I mean, there's a few things when you're talking about chemistry, and one is, you know, chemistry in terms of, do line mate skills match up well together, like playmakers and goal scorers? They would work better together than if you had, you know, three playmakers on a line or three shooters on a line. So there's that kind of chemistry that when players come together, and maybe Hillary can talk about this, is that your skills match up and the way your styles of play match up well. And I think that's something that I would like to find out if we can quantify and categorize players with certain skill types and see how they mesh with other skill type players.
Absolutely. I think, just from my own experience, I've got a line mate who is very good in the defensive zone. I've got another line mate who is just outside of NHL speed. So the different playmaking skills and then a goal scorer in addition to that makes us a deadly and lethal combination. But from a number standpoint, I don't know how you add value to that, but it's definitely a topic that's very interesting and something I think we would be interested in as well.
I love playing with people who are good defensively and you don't have to do anything. You
can just, blue line.
I'll score the goals, yeah.
Well, I think some of the work that people like Ryan Stimson have been doing with the Passing Project, just sort of characterizing guys more like that. And as we learn more about the importance of stuff like Royal Road passing and passes coming out from behind the net, that's probably going to go a long way towards giving descriptive names to what a player's skill set is, and then kind of putting those guys together in the right combination that fits.
This is where I think like some of the tracking, like if the league gets into it, or some of the I've seen some of the Sport Logic stuff. I guess I looked at it, like the, not I'm not talking about the summary statistics necessarily, but sort of like their basically play-by-play file. And I think stuff like that has the potential to be very useful and interesting in terms of identifying how players interact on the ice. I think the off-ice chemistry stuff, I don't know, I'm a little more, it's not that I'm skeptical, like it's more fun to play with people you like, but I think if you're winning, I guess I have two observations. Most fourth liners you hear about are all really good guys. And I think I don't think that's a coincidence. Like, I think people wouldn't have the tolerance for, a high maintenance jerk on the fourth line. Like, as you get lower down the team, and it's not even necessarily about we need a good guy around the room as much as it is we don't want to put up with a jerk who's playing 8 minutes a night. Like, we can find a decent guy who's not going to be a pain in the ass to deal with. So I don't know. I find the chemistry stuff. Like, I do believe there's some value to it. I'm skeptical that it's ever going to be quantified beyond some sort of mumbo-jumbo, like an economic study. But, it's got its limits.
Well, having worked in an NHL organization, like, have you sort of changed your tune a bit in terms of the play, like the personal relations part of it, where it's very easy to kind of be very cold and calculated when you're sitting at home just looking at numbers and being like, this person sucks, he shouldn't be playing, he's not contributing anything of value based on the numbers to his team. But then it's like, also you have to, it's like any other job, you got to go deal with these people on a daily basis and interact with them, and I imagine that probably plays a big role in it.
I wouldn't say that there's like a lot of people, like I don't like the word sucks, like we're talking about the top 1% of the 1%.
Yes.
But I do think you have to recognize that these guys are kind of, there was a great article in like a 2002 Baseball Prospectus talking about the talent distribution and how it's not like a bell curve, it's like the far right tail of the bell curve. It's just that little bit on the end. And as you get further down, as you get further away from like Sidney Crosby, there's more and more people who have that level of ability, right? So, I do think that the personal, the personal relations, matter. Like, Matt, I'll give you an example in Edmonton. Matt Hendricks, very good person, very upbeat, always, always happy, always in a good mood at the rink. And I think that he's an outgoing personality as well. And I think having someone on our team, I do think that's important. And, we were lucky that Matt could also play. But, it was a case where, I do think that matters. It's just a question of how much you're going to pay for it, how long you're going to commit to it. And, I don't think you can make a team that's bad good by adding some good character guys. I'm skeptical of that.
Josh, do you have any thoughts on the idea of chemistry and player relations and all this?
In terms of chemistry, in terms of who plays with who and lines like that, I think one thing I've noticed is, as you've all said, that's hard to quantify. The one thing is, again, getting back to quality of competition and role, is that what I've seen, and not even necessarily with our team, but like when you just look at the numbers, you see a lot of this wowie analysis where a guy is way better with one player, or there's a guy that drags down everybody he plays with. And I think there's some examples of guys who it's just that everybody plays worse with them because when they play with them, they're playing against the best players.
Absolutely. So I completely agree with that, yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, that's all I really have to say for on that point. In terms of the personal relationships, everybody has a job to do. I mean, I have a relationship with a lot of our players. They're wonderful people, and but they have a job to do. We have a job to do. Just, it is what it is.
Josh, you and Hillary might have some insight on this too, but just again on the character point, like, my sense is that like 98% of the players in the league are decent people, and some of them are better than others. And then maybe you have 1% at the one end who are just unbelievable people, and it's probably even less than that. And maybe you have 1% at the other end who are just really bad people, like, and not even really bad, but just like difficult and disruptive in a dressing room. But I think like the ratio of time that's spent talking about that versus the actual number of people in the league who can actually swing your team one way or another. This is just, you know, my observation. I've met some guys, but, you know, I think that it's probably a little bit out of whack.
Probably.
Yeah. I don't know what your experience is. Like, most of you played a lot of people. Are there that many people who are like, this person is so awful?
No.
She is destroying the culture?
No, I mean, it's really hard to find somebody like that. Yeah. And I don't know if it's just from a staff standpoint or the culture that we've created just from a team in general, but... I get along with all my teammates, and you know there have been teams where there's maybe one person, but once you get out on the ice, it's business and it's your job, and you got to play the game, and you get so involved and immersed in the game that you don't really even think about that.
And if you win enough, you probably don't care.
Yeah, right? If you're winning, it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
So,
is there anything we haven't talked about yet that you guys are think we should dive into?
Oh, I think something that's coming that's interesting is sort of coaching and pushing this into coaching. Mm-hmm. You know, and again, this is where the data companies come in. The big thing for me and like the big takeaway for me over the past couple of years has been people need to, you know, make stuff actionable. So, you know, if you have some abstract number, that's not particularly useful. If you can say, hey, your team's awful after you win a face-off at 4-on-5 in your own end, you know, you guys are horrific compared to the rest of the league, then you've given, you know, a coach something that he can take away and use that and get into, okay, well, what are we doing differently than other teams?
Right.
So why are we so bad? And that's something that's coming, and I, you know, I'm surprised I haven't seen more of it, pardon me, in the public eye this year. Like, I mentioned Dom's post. Another great post I saw, it was, he's been on your podcast, Prashant Thayer.
Prashant Thayer, yeah.
It was fantastic stuff because it wasn't just an abstraction. It was thinking about how the game works. And he got into looking at penalty kills and how individual players' numbers were affected by whether they were used for face-offs or not. There's a huge difference. If you're starting in your own end and a face-off on the penalty kill, you're going to be on for a ton of shots against. If you're the coach's second or third option and you're always coming over while the other team's, you know, trying to break out again or making a change, it's going to impact your numbers. And that, to me, is where there's a lot of opportunity right now. Again, if you're a young person looking to get into this, there's a lot of groundbreaking work that can be done there in terms of better understanding the value of the player, the context he's playing in. And not just that, but identifying coaching strategies that can be successfully implemented. And that's where I think that there's, you know, I guess Matt Cain, who I see sitting there, he's written a lot about four forwards and one defenseman. And that's something... You know, it's probably not entirely because of Matt, but Matt wrote his post at the start of last year. Last year was the first time the league used 4F and 1D more than three forwards and two defensemen. Mm-hmm. So I really think that, you know, the coaches will respond to the data if it's presented them in a way that it's actionable and that they can kind of consider the implications of it through their own filter, through their own process, as opposed to, okay, well, here's my number, and this is what it means, and you should do what this says.
Are you surprised that just generally or do you think there's an area of opportunity there to be focusing more on extracting every little bit of value out of special teams play, both on the power play and the penalty kill? Because it seems like so much of the public analysis is generally focused and centered around 5-on-5 play for good reason, obviously.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. And it's funny, Scott Housen, who's Josh's old boss and one of my old bosses, he's very good because he would take the stuff in and then he'd say, this is what's wrong. And or this is where you should dig deeper. And one of the first things, you know, I guess probably the second time I met Scott, we were talking about that, and he said, you guys spend too much time on 5-on-5 and not enough time on special teams. And at that time, special team stuff publicly was pretty limited to looking at shot rates, et cetera, et cetera. And, you know, since then, I've done a bunch of stuff kind of, particularly in the last 7 or 8 months privately, because I thought Scott had a really good point about how we evaluate people. And when I saw Prashanth's piece last year, I wasn't very happy because I was kind of digging into something similar myself. But I do think that, special teams are an area where there's opportunity. Like, one of the cool things I've seen this year, I've been doing my own version of them, but Micah McCurdy's also been doing those maps that show how power play units work. Mm-hmm. And it's a shame. I should have tweeted one out before we came up. But if you look at how Columbus's first unit power play was this year, it's like you can see just from the shot locations how the power play works. It's like a story in and of itself.
Yeah, you sent it to me in December. I'm like, yeah, that's our power play.
Yeah. So it's very, very cool thing. And I think that there's a ton of, opportunity there. And I think there's... that stuff's going to help change the game.
It's like the fifth time you've mentioned Columbus's power play on this panel.
I'm a big fan, although they're number two on my special teams unit of the year. Number one is Carolina's penalty kill. And I think you guys, your power play kind of ran into a roadblock there when you guys played them, back-to-back or twice in a week in January. I think they just shut you right down, and it kind of sent you into a bit of a tailspin, like the Carolina penalty kill.
Yeah.
Has been incredible.
Well, we see more focus on power plays, obviously. I mean, everyone likes goals, and it makes sense. But I think even the penalty kill might be an even more interesting area worth exploring, like how teams try to combat this shift that we've seen to that four forward set.
Yeah, well, and it's again, now, I'm curious, do you have any thoughts on penalty killing, or do you let other people do that?
I try to get out there as much as I can. But no, it's interesting is... we just tried the four forward power play, and it was very interesting. It was sort of nerve wracking being one of the forwards back and thinking, this isn't my traditional role, but also thinking on the other side, it's like, okay, I wonder how the penalty killers are going to try to combat what we're throwing at them, because it's now very confusing and it's something they haven't seen. So I think that's a huge competitive advantage when you can throw a different look and get more opportunities.
Well, and it's, it's interesting. Like, the NHL is obviously further into this, and it's, like, one of the things that we're starting to see is there's a few teams that I think are starting to figure out the 4F1D, and you can see it in the rate that they allow shots from defensemen to get on the net, and for years, that number's been consistent throughout the NHL, and this year, there's a big downtick, and if you're looking just at some teams, you're like, okay, this is centered around a few teams, and it's something, like, I kind of was curious about it, so I had somebody ask somebody. And, the sense I get is that it's something that's coaching directed, and the coaches who know each other, there's kind of a chain of them who are currently doing this. And so, that's going to be, that to me is a case where if you have access to good data and you know how to filter through it, if you're going to play against, say, Tampa Bay, if you're going to play against, say, Ottawa, and holy cow, these guys are unreal at, blocking or forcing shots wide from the point. So if you're, a team that shoots from the point a lot, maybe you want to reconsider what you're doing in that game. And that's where, talking about, again, not to move off the subject here for you, but talking about constraints, like, I think one thing that would surprise people, and I heard someone else mention it on another panel, but is the constraint in terms of time on preparing for games. Mm-hmm. And hockey's so much more complicated than, it's a mix of complication and frequency of games. So the NBA, I think, is less complicated than hockey. Play games about the same frequency, but you've got your 8 or 9 men, they've got their 8 or 9 men, away you go. Hockey, you've got your forwards, your defensemen, he's got his forwards, his defensemen, there's a power play unit, there's a penalty kill unit, so we have 3 different game states. And if you're a coach going to those games, like, you can't change everything for every game. And particularly in the NHL, frequently you're playing back-to-back, and you can't rewire your players before every game. So I think there's a real... Now, what I do think you can do with data is start to identify this is important for this game. Like, this team is good at this, so we want to change this a little bit. And that saves your assistant coaches only have so many hours to review video in their day, too, right? And so if you can start to isolate the stuff that's important, I think you can start to prepare better for games. And, like, one thing that did strike me about your power play was there was things I was like, why isn't anyone trying this against it? And then I watched you guys play one team, like, twice in succession. And it was so funny because in the first game, you ran the little Werenski to Wenberg, and the penalty killers run around, and Gagne's wide open. And so it goes like Werenski, Wenberg to Gagne, high tip goal. And the next game, you played them like fairly recently. The next game, they wouldn't give you that shot. And you came at them another way and scored. But it was amazing to me how they adapted when they saw you twice in close succession. But I think because teams see each other so infrequently in the NHL, it takes the league longer to adapt than it maybe should to something like that?
That might be true. I mean, I hadn't thought about that, but that's a good point. I mean, it's not like the, and it's also the amount of games you have to play in between when you play them. It's yes. not like if in the NFL you have a week to game plan and watch video and prep for every opponent. You play Columbus, and then you play, the next night you're playing somebody else, 2 nights later you're playing somebody else, and then you've played 30 games before you get back to Columbus, and when you play Columbus the next time, it might be the second of a back-to-back, and you had to prepare for somebody else the day before. I mean, I don't get too much into what our coaches are doing down there, but that could certainly be possible.
Yeah, and I think even more than that, like, you know, if you're John Tortorella and you have so many hours in your day, are you better investing an hour in worrying about the Vancouver Canucks, you know, say you're playing them, or are you better investing an hour in worrying about your player? Because that hour you invest in your player is going to pay dividends, not just in the Vancouver game, but in the game after that, the game after that, the game after that. And so I think that there's an area there where, you know, done correctly, data can provide coaches with a real advantage.
And I think this will become more important when we have player tracking, because we will be able to use computer algorithms to identify these common plays that teams use a lot quicker and easier than watching a whole bunch of video.
Just to add on that, I think you can do some of that now. If you know how to like parse the data correctly, you can't look at the video through the data, but you can parse the data and you go, okay, there's something in here. And you can really narrow down where you need to look. And looking in the right place will get you a long way towards getting the right answer.
Yeah, I agree. Guys, that's all the time we have for today's hockey panel. Thanks to everyone for coming and listening to us talk about this game for a while. And yeah, I guess that's a wrap.